Hello and welcome to Tap That MTG, the show where we tell you everything we know about Magic the Gathering that's probably wrong, but fun to talk about. Today we are bringing you another pre-con deep dive from the Commander Master set. In this video, we're just going to break down the cards for you, tell you what the deck is all about, what it's meant to do, how to use it wisely, and if you wait till the end, we'll offer you some tweaks and suggestions for this deck to make it even better. By the way, my name is Leslie and my counterpart here is...
Shauna!
Perfect. And Shauna, my favorite person, is going to tell you all about this deck, what its name is, and who our commander is.
All right. So this is the Enduring Enchantments. And you can guess from that name that it's got a few enchantments in this deck. So this deck is all about playing lots of enchantment creatures and attacking with those. You're going to possibly use them up again later, turn them into zombies, as well as their original, who they are. So they're zombified little puppies or whatever. And you're going to hopefully draw some cards if you're going to use your second commander. And so, yeah, you should have lots of enchantments and maybe sagas, turn them into creatures too, who knows. So you're going to have a lot of fun with enchantments. It's not about sitting back. You're going to be doing lots of attacking, let's just say. So... Mm. So our commander is Anakthea, Hand of Erebos, and we have for two and a white and black and green, so 4/4 with menace, and other enchantment creatures you control have menace as well, so that's going to make them hard to stop. And whenever she enters the battlefield or attacks, you get to exile up to one target non-aura enchantment from your graveyard and create a token that's a copy of that card, except it's 3/3 zombie in addition to its other types. So all the other things that's on the card, plus it's a 3/3 now, zombie.
Nice.
The secondary commander that you might want to think about using is Narsi the Fable Singer. She's a little cheaper, 3/3 for one and the white, black, and green. And she has lifelink, which is nice. Whenever you sacrifice an enchantment, though, you get to draw a card. So those sagas and stuff, if you're going to go that way when you finish those sagas, that you're sacrificing it, so you get to draw a card. And whenever the final chapter ability of a saga you control resolves, you also, each opponent loses X life and you gain X life, where X is that saga's mana value. So again, if you're going to go down that saga road, you might want to use her for your commander. Another way to play the deck. So Leslie's going to tell us a little bit about the mana curve, how this deck is broken down, and explain what it looks like as far as mana stuff goes.
Yeah, so the guts of our deck, starting with the mana curve, we have 3 at 0 to 1, 14 at 2 mana cost, 15 at 3, 12 at 4, 7 at 5, and 3 at 6 plus. So it has a nice little mountain peak. That's what we want to see, mostly in 2s and 3s. So it's going to be fairly easy to play this deck. Color breakdown wise, we have 24 green, 10 black, 11 multicolor, and 16 white. Only 2 colorless cards, which is interesting to see, because I think they went more on the enchantment kind of road instead of the artifact road. So we will see that when we get into our mana ramp. And then as far as card types go, of course, we have 1 planeswalker, 2 artifacts, 25 enchantments, 6 instants and sorceries. We also have 18 enchantment creatures on top of the 25 enchantments. So lots of enchantments, and then 11 just vanilla creatures that do stuff, which might be helpful.
Definitely.
So we also like to break down our decks, weighing them against a nice little commander formula that we use. And Sean is going to tell you all about that and about how this deck stacks up.
Yeah. So our little formula that we follow has, of course, our commander plus 15 ramp. So those are the cards that, the mana kind of cards. Card draw, about 13 of those. Removal, about 15. High impact cards, the cards that are going to win you the game, about 12 of those, and about 10 support cards that are going to help you win the game or help those high impact cards win the game, and about 34 lands is what we recommend. And this deck is pretty similar if you look at what we think it has. So As far as the ramp and mana, you know, it's got 16 compared to the 15. Tutoring, it's 11 compared to the 13. Removal, it's 12 compared to the 15. A little low on the high impact pieces. So 7 versus the 12, but it has tons of support. So your winning pieces are going to maybe work better for you with all that support that's in there. So 16 versus the 10. Mm-hmm. And it does have quite a bit of land. It's got 37 land in it. But the lands have some really interesting things going on with them. So again, the lands in these decks are pretty amazing. So take a look at those when you get a chance. Mm-hmm.
Don't forget to use your mana ability or land abilities.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. So I'll let Leslie tell us about our first card.
Well, our first section is ramp and mana generators. We recommend 15. This deck has 16. Our first is a nice little Composer of Spring. He's a Satyr Bard for 2. He's a 1/3. Now, he has Constellation, which is super fun. So he's not an enchantment creature, but he takes advantage of enchantments. So Constellation are cards that whatever it says on the card is what the Constellation is. But basically, it's whenever an enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, something happens. In this case, you may put a land card from your hand onto the battlefield tapped. And if you control 6 or more enchantments, instead you may put a creature or land card from your hand onto the battlefield tapped. So lots of choices there. Some way to get something free onto the battlefield, maybe something that's pretty expensive onto the battlefield, just by playing an enchantment. And again, there are so many enchantments. So great way to take advantage of playing them.
Yeah, so maybe you could sneak out the Courser of Krufix, which is a 1/2 green, a 2/4. And you get to play with the top card of your library revealed. And you may play lands from the top of your library. And nice. Whenever land comes in, you get to gain a life. So this could do a lot of work for you while it's out.
Yep. Dryad of Elysian Grove. For 3, it's a 2/4. You may play an additional land on each of your turns. Again, these additional lands are so great to have to ramp up. Lands you control are every basic land type in addition to their other types. So now your mana fixing is set when you have this one out as well.
And Greater Tanuki, this is a nice, powerful little doggy that's an enchantment creature as well. A 6/5 for 6. That has trample, which you can't go wrong with that. But it also has channel. So channel is you, in this case, you pay 2 and a green and discard the Tanuki and search your library for a basic land card and put it on the battlefield tapped and shuffle. So maybe you're going to do something with it later on. That might be
so, what you need to do. Correct me if I'm wrong, but that means that instead of casting it and having a 6/5, you could pay 3 and do the channel ability instead?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So you wouldn't get, and it would go in your graveyard. You wouldn't get to play it.
Cool. But maybe you can bring it back. We'll see.
Yeah.
Nessian Wanderer for 2 is a 1/3. Also has Constellation. So this one, whenever an enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, you're going to look at the top 3 cards of your library, reveal a land card from among them, and put that card into your hand, the rest at the bottom of your library in random order.
Cool. Sanctum Weaver, another enchantment creature, is 0/2 for 2, and it can tap the Dryad. So you can tap to add X mana of any one color, where X is the number of enchantments you control.
Ooh, that's going to be big soon. That's awesome. And then we have the basic ones. Farseek, search your library for a Plains, Island, Swamp, Mountain card, put it onto the battlefield, tapped, and then shuffle. Boring, but awesome.
Yep. You need it. Kodama's Reach for 2 and a green. It's the sorcery that says search your library for up to 2 basic lands. Put one on the battlefield. You have to reveal them. Put one on the battlefield tapped and the other in your hand. And shuffle.
And if that wasn't good enough, you have Rampant Growth. Search your library for a basic land card. Put that card onto the battlefield tapped, then shuffle.
And then the only 2 artifacts that are in this deck are Arcane Signet and Soul Ring, which have to be in every commander deck now.
Yeah.
The Arcane Signet taps for 1 mana, and the Soul Ring, of course, taps for 2. So, yeah, those are the only artifacts in this deck.
And then I love Abundance. This is great for mana as well as card draw because it lets you choose. So for 4, you get the nice little enchantment on the battlefield. which you want. If you would draw a card, instead you can choose land or non-land card and reveal cards from the top of your library until you reveal a card of the chosen kind. Put that card into your hand and the other cards revealed this way go to the bottom of your library. So if you decide that at this point I need some land, then you're going to say land and you're just going to go get a land. And if it's a non-land that you want, then you just reveal cards until you get a non-land. So it just gives you your choices.
Yeah. So here's a really good candidate. The Font of Fertility is that you can make turn into a zombie later on. So it is a, for one, it has an enchantment that says you can pay one in a green and sacrifice it to search your library for a basic land and then put it on the battlefield, tap and shuffle. And then later on, turn it into a zombie.
Yeah. And in Helmy Heart Expedition for two, an enchantment landfall, whenever a land enters the battlefield under your control, you can put a quest counter on it. And then you can remove three quest counters and sacrifice it to search your library for two basic land cards, put them onto the battlefield tapped, then shuffle.
There you go. Omen of the Hunt for two and a green, another enchantment that has flash. Right on their turn, and all of a sudden when it enters the battlefield, you may search your library for a basic land card, put on the battlefield tapped, then shuffle. Again, that whole sacrificing it, but this time you get to scry to turn into a zombie later.
Yeah, I, you know, until we started looking at this deck, I didn't realize how many enchantments had sacrifice on them. Like, you just, because, you know, you use them, but you don't really think about, I'm sacrificing artifacts. Yeah. So I was like, well, how could that be, right? So, I mean, the second commander option might be a good one. Yeah. Mending of Dominaria is our first saga. So what the heck is a saga? These are things that are basically like a little book that has three pages. Yeah. You put it onto the battlefield, and then after your draw step, you add a lore counter. So when it comes in, you're going to put one lore counter on it, and you're going to do whatever is beside door number one. So in this card, it is mill two cards. Or in this case, it's mill two cards. Then you may return a creature card from your graveyard to your hand, which there is fantastic. It might be something you just put there. It might be, you know, whatever. The next time you have a turn after you draw, you're going to put it to number two. You're going to do the same thing. And then the next time you have a turn, you're going to draw, and then you're going to turn it to number three and return all the land cards from your graveyard to the battlefield. Then shuffle your graveyard back into your library. So you get all your cards back that you milled. It's fine. Everything's good. And then you're going to sacrifice this saga after. So this will be the only thing in your graveyard. And again, you just sacrificed a saga.
There you go. Then we're into our removal section. So this deck is pretty on par with the 11 or so, according to the formula, about 13. And first we have Kallax, the Destiny's Hand. This is a really, really good planeswalker for this deck. Specifically because it has plus one, look at the top four cards of your library. You may reveal an enchantment card from among them and put that card in your hand, put the rest in the bottom of your library. His minus three is exile target creature or enchantment you don't control until target enchantment you control leaves the battlefield. Tuck him under something. And then minus seven, return all enchantment cards from your graveyard to the battlefield.
So great.
Yeah.
Kallax is such a great planeswalker. Anything Kallax, any of the Kallax planeswalkers could go in this deck for sure. Eidolon, the Blossom.
I think so. Yeah.
Eidolon. I think so. For four is a 2/2. It has constellation. I get all the constellation ones. So whenever you Eidolon of Blossom or another enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, you get to draw a card.
Go. Nice. Easy.
Yeah.
Why not? Drawing all the cards. Erebos, Bleak-Hearted, a 5/6 enchantment creature god with indestructible. It's not going anywhere. Pay four. But as long as your devotion to black is less than five, it's not a creature. So devotion is the number of those black pips, those little skulls. So you need five of those or it's not a creature. But that's okay. Whenever another creature you control dies, you may pay two life. And if you do, you get to draw a card.
Yep.
Or you can pay one in a black and sacrifice another creature. And target creature gets -2/-1 until end of turn. Remove something. That would be good. I think that would be really good. or you can draw a card.
And if you're talking about tucking something under a enchantment that you control, this is an enchantment. And yeah. It's an indestructible one, so it would be a good choice if it's out on the battlefield. Mesa Enchantress for 3 is a 0/2. Whenever you cast an enchantment spell, you get to draw a card.
Nice. Simple. Easy.
Simple.
There we have Narsi, the Fable Singer. We talked about her before. So this is where whenever you sacrifice an enchantment, you get to draw a card, a little 3/3. And whenever the final chapter ability of a saga resolves, each opponent loses X and you gain X, where X is that saga's mana value. Extra value.
I get all the easy ones. Satyr Enchanter for 3 is a 2/2. Whenever you cast an enchantment spell, draw a card.
There we go. Which would work really cool with the spirited companion, little puppy. 1/1. When he comes in, you get to draw a card. So you're gonna draw 2 cards that turn. Mm-hmm. Or 3 cards total that turn, just from that playing that doggy.
Yeah. Scythe's Harvest Hand for 2 is a 1/2. Whenever you cast an enchantment spell, you gain 1 life and draw a card.
These are all so cheap. You're going to be drawing cards like crazy.
Yeah. Hopefully. Right? And there's enough of them that you should get at least a couple on the battlefield.
Enduring Enchantress does the same thing. Whenever you cast an enchantment spell, you may draw a card.
Yep.
Leslie, guess what? Next one?
Enchantress's Presence for 3 is an enchantment. Whenever you cast an enchantment spell, draw a card. Now, the reason I like this one better than the other ones is because it's an enchantment. It's harder to get rid of. Board wipes will kill the rest of them, and then you don't get your card draw anymore. But this one will stay on the battlefield, hopefully, unless someone is going to destroy all your enchantments or this one.
Yeah. Love Song of Night and Day. It's a beautiful card.
Look at
it. So nice. It's just saga. They're in love. You pay 1. You and target opponent each draw 2 cards, make some friends, as Leslie always says. And when you get to 2, you get to create a 1/1 white birdie with flying. And at 3, you get to put a 1/1 counter on each of up to 2 target creatures to make your little birdie bigger. There you go.
And this one has read ahead.
Oh, yes. I didn't explain that. I skipped that part entirely. I read ahead. You can skip any of those to get to the end. So you could skip number 1 and just start at number 2, or you could skip all the way to the end and just put the counters on and then sacrifice it at the end.
Great choices. Mm-hmm. Removal, removal, removal. What's time to talk about removal for 5? We recommend 15. This deck has 12. So good start. Doomwake Giant for 5 is a 4/6. It has, guess what? Constellation. Whenever Doomwake Giant or another enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, what do you get to happen? Creatures your opponents control get -1/-1 until the end of turn. So if they got a bunch of little 1/1s that they've been building up, board wipe.
Or you just play a whole bunch of enchantments and -4. Mind Rack Harpy. It is a 3/2 flyer enchantment creature. At the beginning of combat on your turn, each player puts the top 3 cards of their library into their graveyard. You don't mind so much. They might mind.
You can bring them back as zombies. Calling Ritual for 4 is a sorcery that allows you to destroy each non-land permanent with mana value 2 or less, and add a black or a green for each permanent destroyed this way. So that will include yours. So just kind of be careful what you do there.
Yeah. Extinguish All Hope for 4 and 2 black. This is destroy all non-enchantment creatures. Good one-sided board wipe there.
That would extinguish all hope. Path to Exile for 1. Again, a little staple card. Exile target creature. Its controller may search their library for a basic land card, put it onto the battlefield tapped, and then shuffle. So they get a land out of it, but you're going to exile a creature.
Here's a must-include saga, Binding the Old Gods for 2, black and a green. That number 1 is destroy target non-land permanent and opponent controls. Could be one of their planeswalkers or something. Number 2, you get to search your library for a forest card, so it's got a little bit of ramp on there, too. And number 3 is creatures you control get death touch until end of turn. Swing in for the win.
Cacophony Unleashed for 5 and a black and a black.
Wow.
That's 7. That's crazy. It's an enchantment. And when Cacophony Unleashed enters the battlefield, if you cast it, destroy all non-enchantment creatures. Whew. So this isn't if it comes back from your graveyard, just when you cast it. And whenever Cacophony Unleashed or another enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, until the end of turn, Cacophony Unleashed becomes a legendary 6/6 nightmare god creature with menace and death touch, and is still an enchantment. So you're just going to be making it into a 6/6, and then it's going to turn back into enchantment to be safe until your next turn. It's fantastic.
Cast out a handy little enchantment removal that has flash, and you can, when it enters the battlefield, exile target non-land permanent opponent controls until this leaves the battlefield. Could be any permanent, which is really non-land, which is really helpful, or you could just cycle it, which means you pay one and discard it and draw a card instead. If you don't need it, you can use it for card draw.
Yep. Cunning Rhetoric for 3 is an enchantment that whenever an opponent attacks you and or a planeswalker you control, exile the top card of that player's library. You may play that card for as long as it remains in exile, and mana of any type can be spent to cast it. So it will deter them from attacking you because they don't want to lose the top thing off their library.
Ghoulish Impetus for 2 and a black enchanted creature. You enchant one of their creatures. It gets +1/+1 and has death touch and is goaded. And when it dies, you get to return the impetus to the battlefield at the beginning of the next end step. So it's just never going to go away.
When did this impetus get created? There was a whole bunch of impetuses that were created pre-COVID, I think. And I loved them, but I don't remember Ghoulish Impetus and when it was created.
I think it might be new. I'm not sure.
It's cool. I love it. Grasp of Fate for 3 is an enchantment. And when Grasp of Fate enters the battlefield, each opponent exiles up to one target non-land permanent that player controls until Grasp of Fate leaves the battlefield. So they're just going to pick something that they're going to tuck under it. They get to choose, but nice removal.
Yeah. And Eldest Reborn, another great saga that is removal. Yes. And each opponent sacrifices a creature or planeswalker. And 2 is each opponent discards a card. And 3 is you get to put target creature or planeswalker from a graveyard, any of them, onto the battlefield under your control. Mm-hmm. Nice.
And now we are on to the high impact game winning cards. They're going to turn the tides for you. And gosh, they sure will. So our formula, we like to suggest 12. This deck has 7, so we're a little light on that. But again, your support may help with that. We'll get to that in a minute. We have Archon of Sun's Grace as our first one for 4. It's a 3/4. It has flying. It has lifelink. Pegasus creatures you control have lifelink. And its constellation is whenever you cast an enchantment or an enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, create a 2/2 white Pegasus creature token with flying. And actually, I will explain why I reworded that to say what the deck says, because it does not say cast. It says whenever an enchantment enters the battlefield. Mm-hmm. So when your commander brings it back out of the graveyard, it's still entering the battlefield, even though it's a zombie. Mm-hmm. So it will trigger the Pegasus as well, because you don't have to cast to make that happen.
Right on. Demon of Fate's Design, a 6/6 for 6 flying trampoly demon dude. And once during each of your turns, you may cast an enchantment spell by paying life equal to its mana value rather than paying its mana cost. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that could be good. Lovely. Mm-hmm. Especially if you have lots of Pegasus gaining you life. Mm-hmm. And you can pay 2 and a black and sacrifice another enchantment. And this guy gets +X/+0 until end of turn, where X is the sacrificed enchantment's mana value. Remember, he has trample.
Crazy. So, yeah. Demon fire breathing. Heliod, God of the Sun, 4/3. It's a 5/6. It's indestructible. As long as your devotion to white is less than 5, Heliod is not a creature. But once it's up to 5, that's fantastic. Other creatures you control have vigilance, which is great. And for 4, you can create a 2/1 white cleric enchantment creature token, which would be an enchantment entering the battlefield.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Nyxborn Behemoth for 10 and 2 green. It's a 10/10, but it costs X less to cast, where X is the total mana value of non-creature enchantments you control. Could be lots.
It's going to cost you 2.
That's trample. And you can pay one in a green and sacrifice another enchantment, and he gains indestructible until end of turn.
Crazy. It's okay if you sacrifice enchantments quickly. Because you can sacrifice one of the enchantment cleric things. It's great. Yep. Battle of Hellvault. This one is another saga. The first two chapters for each player exile up to one target non-saga, non-land permanent that player controls until Battle of Hellvault leaves the battlefield, which will be after the third chapter. But on chapter three, you create Avacyn, a legendary 8/8 white angel creature token with flying, vigilance, and indestructible. So there's that. I need that for my angel deck.
Yeah, you do. Oh, gosh. Boon of the Spirit Realm. This is for 3 and 2 white, a enchantment with constellation. Whenever it or another enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, you get to put a blessing counter on the boon. And creatures you control get +1/+1 for each blessing counter on it.
Oh, that's so awesome. Game changing. And then Mirari's Wake. Creatures you control get +1/+1, but the really cool thing about this is whenever you tap a land for mana, you add 1 mana of any type of that land produces as well. So it basically turns all your mana into 2 instead of 1, which will allow you to get all kinds of enchantments out on your turn.
So then in the support section, there are a lot. There's about 16 compared to the formula of 10, but these are lots of little enchantments that are cheap. They're going to get out there and do the things, do all the enchantments, interlink the battlefield things. So it's really going to be overwhelming on the board for your opponents to deal with. So our first one is Arasta of the Endless Web. For 3/5, it's a spider with reach. It's a 3/5. And whenever an opponent casts an instant or sorcery spell, you get to create a 1/2 spider token with reach. So keeping them off of you, keeping them from doing their things.
Also, I have this thing that just popped into my head that I just want to stand on my soapbox and say, because the two decks that we're kind of talking about first, the Planeswalker one and the Enchantment ones, are the ones that not many people want for whatever reason. They're just not as popular. Of course, because they're up against Eldrazi and Sliver Swarm or whatever it is.
Yeah.
But as far as complication goes, the Planeswalker one and the Enchantment one have a lot more triggers. They have a lot more things going on. Mm-hmm. Whereas the Eldrazi and the Sliver Swarm are just like big creatures, swing in. It's super easy. So if you want something that's going to make you think a little bit, these ones might be the option for you.
Mm-hmm.
Soapbox done. Destiny Spinner for two is a 2/3. Creatures and enchantment spells you control can't be countered, which is great for all those blue players out there. For 4, you can also target land you control becomes an XX elemental creature token with trample and haste until the end of turn, where X is the number of enchantments you control. It is still a land. Oh my gosh, you remember how many enchantments we had in this deck? Was it 28 and 18? There's a good chance it's going to be a pretty big beefy trampler. I love it.
It's just land.
Yeah. Nice support.
Right? Herald of the Pantheon, a little 2/2 for 2, a little shaman that says enchantment spells you cast cost 1 less to cast. And whenever you cast an enchantment spell, you gain a life. Gaining life is nothing to complain about for sure.
Nope.
And having them cost 1 less is awesome.
Yep. 2. Jukai Naturalist for 2. It's a 2/2 lifelink. Again, nothing wrong with that. And it also makes enchantment spells cost 1 less to cast. Mm-hmm. So
then we have another spider. This one is a 2/3 for the black and the green and a 1 with reach. Of course, spiders like to have reach. And at the beginning of your upkeep, you have to mill 2 cards, but you don't care about that. Cards in your graveyard is okay for you. And you can pay 1 and a black and a green and exile this and return a target card from your graveyard to your hand.
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
Good way to get your commander back from your graveyard if you happen to have it in your graveyard.
Yeah.
Ondu Spirit Dancer. Whenever an enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, you may create a token that's a copy of it. Do this only once each turn. So the very first... I mean, you may, so you get to choose. It doesn't have to be the very first one, but one of your enchantments, you get to make a copy of each turn, which is great.
Citizen Champion, a 1/3 for 3. with Consolation, whenever an enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, you get to put a 1/1 counter on it and draw a card.
Yep. Starfield Mystic is another one of our enchantments. Cost one colorless less to cast. Whenever an enchantment you control is put into a graveyard from the battlefield, that would include your sagas, you get to put a 1/1 counter on Starfield Mystic.
Then we have Battle for Bredegard. It's a little one and a green and a white saga that lets you create, first of all, a human token, then an elf on chapter 2. And chapter 3, you get to choose any number of artifact tokens and or creature tokens you control with different names. For each of them, you get to create a token that's a copy of it. Copies of your tokens. Zombies, whatever. They're all going to be named differently.
And Dreadhorde Invasion. This can be a risky one. But you have 40 life to start with, so hopefully you get this out early. Because if you can afford the 6 life that it's going to take away from you, then you are going to be able to swing in with a big life linker. So basically, at the beginning of your upkeep, you lose 1 life and you amass a zombie. So you have a zombie army token, and you're just going to put a 1/1 counter on it. And then each time you amass, then you're going to put another counter on it. So it's just going to keep getting bigger and bigger as the game goes on. Now they may kill your zombie and then you have to start over again. And so if it's not 6, then you're going to have to keep losing 1 life. And actually, even when it's a 6/6 and you're gaining life, you're losing life. So it can be risky, but it's fun to play with.
Yep. I've had lots of fun with that card. Felidar Retreat. This is a awesome enchantment for 3 and a white. Has landfall whenever a land enters the battlefield. You get to choose whether you want to create a 2/2 cat beast creature token or put a 1/1 counter on each creature you control, and they get vigilance until end of turn.
So good.
Yes.
So good.
Tokens.
Omen of the Sun for 3 is an enchantment that has flash, which means you can cast it at any time. You could cast an instant, which is fantastic. When Omen of the Sun enters the battlefield, you create 2 1/1 white human creature soldiers tokens, and you gain 2 life. You can then pay 2 and sacrifice Omen of the Sun to scry 2. We always say instants are for battle or attacking. So it's a good one to play when you need to have a couple blockers that they didn't know you were going to have.
Yep. Definitely. Sandworm Convergence. I love playing this card against Leslie.
Why? Because Leslie always has flyers.
Leslie always has flying and I never do. So an enchantment, Sandworm Convergence, has 6 and for 6 and 2 green though. But creatures with flying can't attack you or planeswalkers you control. So it says, back off, Leslie. Yeah, and I'm gonna make at the beginning of my end step, I'm gonna make a green 5/5 green worm.
Yeah, I'm just gonna keep doing it.
Whatever.
Is the worst.
Get away from me.
Sigil of the Empty Throne for 5 is an enchantment that has, whenever you cast an enchantment spell, you get a 4/4 white angel creature token with flying. So how's that for a constellation?
Exactly. Play your little enchantment creature and you get to make a 4/4 white angel at the same time.
Yeah.
Starfield of Nyx. It is an enchantment that says, beginning of your upkeep, you may return target enchantment creature or enchantment card, so it could be a creature, from your graveyard to the battlefield. And as long as you control 5 or more enchantments, each other non-aura enchantment you control is a creature in addition to its other types and has base power and base toughness, each equal to its mana value. What? It could be a high, a big impact creature, or big impact card.
But it might be conditional, so.
Yes, it's pretty conditional.
So the Binding of Titans is our last one in this section. For 2, you get a saga. The first chapter is each player mills 3 cards. It doesn't matter. You can have them in your graveyard. We've talked about that. But you get some removal from theirs. Number 2, exile up to 2 target cards from graveyards. It could be theirs. 4 should be theirs. For each creature card exiled this way, you gain 1 life. And chapter 3, you are going to return target creature or land card from your graveyard to your hand.
Thank you, thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay. So thanks for sticking around with us for this long. I should tell you, the lands, there are 37 in this deck. Formula calls for about 34, so you have a little bit of leeway there. So you might want to take a look at those and see if we can get rid of any of them. But like I said before, these lands and these decks are pretty good. So don't get rid of too many. So we're on to our tweaks. And speaking of lands, I'm going to tell you that you need a Reliquary Tower for this deck, because I think you're going to have a ton of cards in your hand. Mm-hmm. So you don't want to lose all those lovely enchantments that you draw.
Yeah.
So.
And then we thought some way to use something like Teleportation Circle would be a great opportunity for four. It is an enchantment in and of itself, which is great. And then at the beginning of your end step, you exile up to one target artifact or creature you control, then return that card to the battlefield under its owner's control. So if you have anything that has an enter the battlefield effect, you can then take it out and bring it back in and get a benefit of that. Your sagas are another good example. You can like just before they're going to die or hit their third one, you can bring it back in and start it over again. So
handy. And then we were thinking it'd be also good to have some enchantments that punish them, because you're not going to have any big stompy things. Really, you're just going to have lots of little things. So a good way to deal damage to them is maybe having cards like the Underworld Dreams, which is for three black and enchantment. That works with your whole enchantment thing, but whenever an opponent draws a card, it deals damage to that player. So punishing them for drawing all their cards would be really helpful for you.
Yeah. And then Curse of Leeches is a 3-mana cost enchantment. You enchant a player, and then, so you would enchant them. And then as this permanent transforms into Curse of Leeches, attach it to a player. And at the beginning of the enchanted player's upkeep, they lose one life and you gain one life. So I'm going to bring this out. I'm going to attach it to Shauna. It's Daybound. If a player casts a no spells per turn, then it becomes Night. Well, what happens when it becomes Night is this card is going to flip over and it's going to become Leeching Lurker, which is a 4/4 with lifelink. And it's Nightbound, and the only way they can get rid of that is to cast two spells. So it's going to come back to you. It becomes a 4/4. And then if they do turn it to day, you get to flip it back over and attach it to another player. It could be a different player. It could be the same player. So it's just a fun little, like, sit back and let it do the work for you card, yep. Which is great.
Revenge of Ravens, very similar sort of idea, an enchantment that says whenever a creature attacks you or a planeswalker you control, that creature creature's controller loses a life and you gain a life. So again, keeping them off of you until you can do your thing.
Yeah. And I know we recommend this card probably more than we should.
She likes it so much.
It's a good card. Ghostly Prison for 3. It's an enchantment. It's great for an enchantment deck. Creatures can't attack you unless their controller pays 2 for each of those creatures attacking you. So it lets you kind of sit back.
Elspeth Conquers Death is kind of an enchantment that you have to include in this deck, because it exiles target permanent. An opponent controls it with converted mana cost 3 or greater. Get rid of their big stupid Eldrazi thing or something, whatever you need to get rid of. And then your number 2 on here is non-creature spells your opponents cast costs 2 more to cast until your next turn. So again, slowing them down a little bit. And then 3 is where you get to return a target creature or planeswalker card from your graveyard to the battlefield and put a 1/1 counter or a loyalty counter on it. So it brings back something good of yours.
Bring something good, like Heliod's Uncrowned, which we also think would be a great enchantment. It's a legendary god for 3. It's a 5/5. It's got indestructible. Your devotion to white is less than 5. He's not a creature, but once you get to the devotion 5, then whenever you gain life, you're going to put a 1/1 counter on it. Plus, you can pay 2, and another target creature gains lifelink until the end of turn. It's not a tap ability, so you can do that as many times as you want to gain some life back.
Yeah, and we talked about how your creatures aren't really big, so it's going to be hard to get through, but all the glitters might help you make a creature big, because it is an aura that says it gets +1, a creature gets +1/+1 for each artifact and or enchantment you control. So maybe that will help your little enchantment creature get bigger.
Mm-hmm. And then Weaver of Harmony is a must add, we think, for this deck. Other enchantment creatures you control get +1/+1, which is fine. But this pay one and tap to copy target activated or triggered ability you control from an enchantment source. You can choose new targets for the copy is fantastic. So an activated ability is one that basically you're paying to activate it. So the one on this card has pay one and you tap, that's activating ability. A triggered ability is like constellation when it says, if this happens, then that happens. It's an if then thing. So all of the constellation stuff. So this allows you to pay one and copy one of those things.
Then we thought that Kanbal, Council of Allocation, it's not an enchantment creature, but it does say whenever an opponent casts a non-creature spell, that player loses 2 life and you gain 2 life. Mm-hmm. Another one of those cards that you can just sneak in there just to keep them off of you and slow them down while you do your thing.
And we talked about Kallax being the Enchantment King. He is guided by fate for 3, and he's a 2/2. He has Constellation. Whenever he or another enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, you get to put a 1/1 counter on target creature. So not just him, you can choose. And when Kallax or an enchanted creature you control deals combat damage to a player, you may create a token that's a copy of non-legendary enchantment you control. Do this only once each turn. But you can imagine some of these enchantments that you have on the battlefield, creating copies of them would be fantastic. I will point out that it's not enchantment creature, it is enchanted creature. So you have to put an enchantment on a creature for it to be enchanted.
Right. Yeah, you're right. Dictate of Helioid, this is a enchantment that has flash for 3 and 2 white that says creatures you control get +2/+2. So again, helping you make your stuff bigger because hopefully you'll have lots of stuff out there. Got to get in for damage sometime.
And Primal Rage, once you do make them bigger, you want them to be able to get in for that damage. So creatures you control have trample would be a nice thing. As an enchantment to add. And again, if you're adding an enchantment, it's going to trigger some of those things and be able to turn into a zombie later. So those little enchantments are going to help you out if you can add them.
All right. So you've made it through our tweaks. That's it for this deck. Thank you so much for watching. You can hang out with us on YouTube and Twitch, or feel free to connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We'd love to hear how you would tweak this deck. What kind of enchantments did we miss? There's lots out there, so what would be a really good one to put in? We'd love to hear it. And that's it for this time. We will see you next time. And in the meantime,
tap those magic cards and have fun doing it. Bye, guys.
Bye, everyone.